Yo!
What's up? This is Patrick.
This is Shane.
And in this video, we're going to talk about Shane's top five things you should do when you're considering using Synapse dedicated pools. Stay tuned. If you find this for the very first time, be sure to hit that subscribe button to stay up to date from all the videos from both Adam and this guy. Shane, first. Thank you so much for taking time out of your busy day to come and hang out with us over here at Guy in the Cube. We appreciate it. But before we get into this, why don't you do a quick introduction to let everybody know who you are and what you do?
Thanks, Patrick. I'm happy to be here. I'm a program manager in the customer success engineering team on the Azure Synapse product, and I get to work with customers all day and help them do interesting things with Azure Synapse.
Nice. Well, Shane, I've been working with SQL Server a very long time, but it's like evolving and changing. And I haven't been tinkering with it a lot, and I'm starting my Synapse journey, and I want to learn all about these new technologies and the new things. So let's just jump into this. All right. So what's number one, Shane?
Yeah, the first thing I like to talk to my customers about is just to verify that they know what they're doing with Azure Synapse, in the sense that Azure Synapse is sort of a specialized version of SQL Server designed to scale out and distribute data. It's really intended for large batches, analytical type queries, analytical workloads. And it's important to note that it's not intended for high volume transaction processing, that sort of thing.
So I wouldn't use Synapse for a sales system or an enrollment system or something like that. It's more, you know, batch processing, large volumes of data, analytical types of workloads.
That's exactly right. Typically, we're pulling in data from those systems, and then we're using the power of our distributed technology to analyze that data.
Nice. All right. So that's number one. Don't use this for your transaction or your highly transactional systems. That's not what Synapse is for. What's the next thing I should do or consider before I get started?
You really need to understand how to design for a distributed architecture. And that means understanding the distributed table options. There's three options you need to be aware of. The first is round robin, which is our default. We also have what we call a hash distribution and replicated. Round robin, when you load data, it's going to take those rows and just split them across the different storage distributions. We got 60 storage accounts on the back end, which we call distribution. And we're just striping data as it comes in.
And then the second one, I think you said replicate?
Yeah, so replicated starts out like round robin, but it is kind of a trick that we're using. It's common in distributed systems where we're actually taking a full copy of the data and loading it to each compute node. So with our distributed architecture, you have the ability to choose how many nodes you have. Each node in your system will pull all the data for the replicated table from Azure storage and store it in memory.
And so the third one, a little more complicated, even sounds a little more complicated, a hash. I think you got a demo to show us how this works, right? So you guys, instead of all this talking, you guys know what I would like to do. Let's do what? Let's head over to Shane's laptop. Oh, Management Studio. All right. So if you haven't watched the video on the tools that we use when managing or developing against Synapse, you should go watch that video. All right, Shane, let's see what you got.
I'm going to go ahead and create a new table to demonstrate what hash tables actually look like. As you say, this is a little more complicated. This is where you would define any of the distribution types. You just swap out this keyword here. Here we've only have one column. And just to keep it simple, let's call this a candy jar. And you are going to insert candy into this jar, into the 60 different buckets that we talked about.
Gotcha.
Creating that table. Now let's go ahead and insert a couple values, and I'll show you where those land. In fact, let's run this a couple times. So this query returned the 60 distributions that we mentioned earlier. And instead of round robin, where it would be inserting them sequentially in all of the different distributions, see, we got 60 distributions. You'll notice that only three of them have values. Number 17, number 28, and number 52. So what happens is there's a hashing algorithm that will take the text that we passed into that hash column, and that the result of that hash will put it in the different bucket. And that makes it deterministic. So if I have two tables that I want to join on that distribution column, we know for sure that those values are aligned on the compute nodes. So it makes our optimizer's job a lot easier. The important thing for your users is that we'll run faster that way.
So if I inserted yellow 100 times, it would put those 100 rows on the exact same distribution every time.
That's correct.
You need to understand the distribution and you need to make sure you specify the right distribution when you're creating your tables. All right, so that's number two, Shane. So what's number three?
Yeah, so number three is indexing. We have a few different index types to be aware of. The default are clustered column store indexes. General rule of thumb, think of just using CCIs for your fact tables.
Gotcha.
Typically, we want more than 60 million rows. The next type to think about is a heap, which you typically aren't using in SQL Server, but for ingestion purposes, like your staging tables and reloading data, heaps can give you actually a pretty big uplift in performance for the ingestion process.
Makes sense. Yeah.
And then we do have the standard clustered indexes as well, which is a row store index that this uses a B-tree structure for storing data.
The B-tree is very similar to what SQL Server does. All right, that's number three. Understand which index to create and when. But then number four, you and I talked about this already. I can think about my SQL Server days. Number four just automatically happened when I was using SQL Server, but it's a little different with Synapse. Why don't you tell us about number four, Shane?
Yeah, so statistics are critical in Synapse, and you need to be very intentional about them because we're not automatically maintaining them for you like you have in SQL Server. We added a feature to do auto create statistics, so you don't have to worry about making sure you have the right ones there, but you have to make sure that you're updating your statistics. And typically what we recommend is after you're doing your batch loads, you go ahead and run your update statistics at the end of those processes.
Gotcha. So after I load my data warehouse, right, after I run my nightly ETL process, part of my ETL process, I should have a update statistics task or something to make sure that everything is in place and that all my statistics are updated after I load my data warehouse. Now let's wrap this up with number five. What's number five, Shane?
Number five is data loading. If you use what we call Polybase or copy into, it's going to do a little bit of magic to get the data loaded more quickly. So if you just run a ECP statement or load the data through SSIS, through our what we call the control node, it's going to create a bottleneck because all that data is trying to go through a single node and then get distributed across our compute nodes. What we want to do is use each of the compute nodes to make those data connections to parallelize that load. If you're loading billions of rows, we want to get that done as quickly as possible. Based on this diagram, this Azure storage layer where the data to be loaded is sitting, each of those nodes is communicating to the individual compute nodes within our cluster. And so we can get significantly faster performance this way.
I think I got it, Shane, but is there anything you could show us to kind of clear that up a little bit?
Yeah, let's just take a look at a quick script. So let me cut over to my laptop. It's a lot simpler than it sounds. This is it. So Polybase is sort of a virtualization layer. We have a bridge that runs on the compute nodes that we can use to ingest external data. In this case, we're creating an external table to pull in some yellow cab data that happens to be sitting in an Azure storage layer somewhere. So I already have the data source created, which points to the location, and we already have the file format, et cetera. So all we got to do is create this external table and define all the columns here, and then that will persist as a logical object. To actually load the data, all we need to do is go down here and run this command. So you see here, I'm selecting everything out of this external table. I'm gonna just take these data types and column names here and drop that in this new staging table. Note that I'm using round robin heap. That will give me the fastest ingestion performance.
Correct me if I'm wrong. So I have all my data in some type of blob storage, and then I can create an external table that points to that storage. And then I can actually query the data from those files. I don't need to ingest them. Actually, part of the ingestion process is me querying that data and then using that second script that you created, create table as, and I select from that, and it'll take all that data and move it as fast as possible into that heap.
That's exactly right. For interactive query, it's not as optimal because we're not doing any caching or like file elimination or anything. But that's exactly right.
All right. Awesome. Well, thank you so much, Shane. Thank you for joining us. Those top five things are going to save so much people so much time when they're getting started with these dedicated SQL pools. All right, guys, what do you think? Are you using these top five best practices that Shane talked about? I'd love to know. Let's continue the conversation. Where? In the comments below. If it's your first time visiting the Guy in the Cube channel, hit that subscribe button. If you like my video, give me a big thumbs up. As always, from Adam,
Shane,
and myself, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next video.